here is basically how it happened.
Oh, wrong place. Let's rewind to the beginning.
Oh, my bad. It all started in 1900. Ernest Rutherford was in Montreal. He found out about half-life and pushed the scientific bounds of what we know about the atom, and got himself a Nobel Peace Prize in the process. And then he went back to Manchester and to do the work that made him famous, but we don't care about that, and so naturally, people instantly jumped upon that.
I think you might have pulled out the information for weird clothing styles and not nuclear physics.
My bad. So the next 30 years went by, and no one really cared, and the only thing that got people to care was the idea of bigger bombs. And then the military went, "We want big kaboom." But wanting the big kaboom leads to big money. So they started looking at how they would develop this technology and realized they need something called heavy water. Heavy water is basically water with a substitute for hydrogen, deuterium, which makes it so that it's not water. And this is like, but they call it heavy anyways, and naturally, because this is what they need, and there is no substitute for this, there's only one place in the world that has it, naturally. And it's a byproduct of some creation of like fertilizer or whatever, but anyways, it's in a case in Norway, and it's only 170 kilograms, which isn't that much for the entire world's stockpile of literally anything. And then France got to it first and bought it for like research purposes, and then Germany looked at them and was like, "Nah, I want that." So they tried to steal it, and they got a decoy of it. But then Germany was like, "Well, if we take over your homeland, we will steal it." And France was like, "Well, I want to lead nuclear development, but Germany's kinda here at home, so I don't want to give them the heavy water, so England, it's a hot potato," and they yeeted it over to England. And England was like, "But I don't have the resources to develop it," and through some slightly complex decisions, they decided to throw it at Canada, because they actually had, 1, money, 2, nuclear physicists, and 3, they weren't in war. All the conditions for a parabola were met, so they threw it over to Canada, and Canada was like, "Yay!" Canada then went on to a river, and they were like, "I know what I'm naming this." They saw a few logs with some chalk markings on it, and then they decided to call it the Chalk River Laboratory. So, anyway, they created a small modular reactor by 1945, and then they went on to make a bigger, more important reactor called the NRX reactor. And this is the subject of our story. The research was great, and they even found more uses than just energy, and they benefited the world. Many medical isotopes were created. And then, on the lucky 7th year, there was a small problem with the reactor. But it was nothing compared to the monstrosity that would unfold. You see, the coolant isn't flowing through their tubes properly. And this is a problem, because if the reactor inside its large aluminum enclosure didn't get cooler, it would explode. And explosion is usually not a good thing. And now at the time, everything was under control. The enclosure itself had many tubes coming out of it, mostly used for inserting and removing control rods. This was all there to make sure that a nuclear reaction was always controlled in such a way that the people were going to always be safe. The date was the 12th of December 1952, and the reactor was set to a low power mode so it could be worked on. Low power mode means that the more control rods are in to further slow the power generation. After that, the job was pretty simple, in principle. The workers had to lift the heavy water depth inside the reactor by about 0.17 meters, or about 6 inches for our non-metric friends. The operator went down to the room, and while some of the handles had been removed to make sure that not too many of the control rods moved, the operator had lifted 3 or 4 by mistake. This changed the air pressure in the reactor such that the control rods started rising out of the reactor. Later, a supervisor called them and told them to stop. Then, that very supervisor went to the basement and closed the valves. Thinking he had solved the problem and that the control rods were back in, he left. Unfortunately for him, those rods had not gone down all the way. The supervisor did what he was supposed to, and though he didn't know all the rods hadn't made it into the reactor, he asked the control center to use the pneumatic system to push the rods down after they were sealed in place. The supervisor told the operator to use codes B-53, and B-54. The operator then put down the phone, and as the machine was saying it was okay to do so, he hit buttons B-53 and B-54. But what he didn't hear was the person yelling on the other side of the phone, screaming at him to stop. The supervisor, turns out, had made an error. That should have been okay because the machine was saying that there were enough control rods in the reactor. But however, there weren't. This is why it's a problem. You see, instead of saying to put the rods back into the reactor, he said the numbers that would take the rods out of the reactor. And this led to the chain reaction of the uranium in the reactor to break apart atoms too fast. You see, very little was stopping the reaction. The coolant was trying to be fixed, and the control rods weren't there. Every 2 seconds, the amount of power this reactor generator was doubling, which would have been great if it was sustainable. But it's not, so they were trying to contain the reactor. And after about 10 seconds, the power coming out of the reactor was about 17 megawatts. This reactor does usually run about 1. It can spike up to more, and it is possible everything can handle it. But if it jumps from 1 to 17 in 10 seconds, that's slightly problematic. And at this point, it's safe to say that literally everything is going wrong. The control rods that were supposed to fall from gravity don't fall, and only 1 in 4 do fall. And when said 1 in 4 rods fall, it falls slower than the DMV, and it takes about 90 seconds to move just a few feet. Worse still, the proper coolant was flowing through the tank, and even without control rods, the worst it could get was about 20 megawatts. The crew tried everything. At this point, they were instructing machines to take away all the water out of the tank. This way, the electrons had nothing to move in and make it impossible for a chain reaction. For a scary 5 seconds, the power kept rising. 80 megawatts. A reactor that was designed to work to produce 20 megawatts at its worst point, and usually ran much below that, was 4 times that amount. Everything was clearly getting out of hand. But then there was a glint of hope, a ray of sunshine, the power started to plummet. 25 seconds, the reactor was off. And while the power had only been above 1 megawatt for about 62 seconds, the problems that had come with it were here to stay. The helium pressure in the reactor was dropping faster than falling off the Grand Canyon. The workers were worried that the tanks supplying the helium were blocked off. What a surprise, the helium wasn't there for laughs. The helium was there to stop the heavy water and other things in the reactor from reacting with the elements. At this point, the only light that started to shine in this entire thing, and the heavy water level stabilized at about 1.34 meters. Not where it should normally be, but currently they didn't want too much power production. Kaboom! It had all gone downhill so quickly. From the mistake in what the supervisor had said on the phone to the explosion was a total of 4 minutes. In 240 seconds, these workers had tried to stabilize a reactor and managed to do it for a second. But the lack of helium was the ultimate problem. The reactor was still going to take things in, and so instead of helium, it took hydrogen and some gases that the heat and the chemical reaction that the fuel rods created. At this point, there was nothing else to happen. There was a hydrogen and oxygen explosion inside of the reactor. And as these people were due some luck in the last 5 minutes, the reactor fortunately did not structurally collapse. So why aren't we done yet? You see, radiation has this tendency to trying to get into everything and harm everyone around it, and it does that well. The water that was used to cool the reactor ended up leaking as there were cracks in the reactor. This water leaked into other tanks. This was going to get into Ottawa River, but fortunately, there was a pipeline built to move it 1.6 kilometers away, where the radioactive water was to stay. They did check if the radioactive water reached the river, and fortunately, as a second stroke of good luck, it didn't. The air, however, was not so lucky. Because some of the reactor was cooled by air during the test, it leaked and got into everything. The neighboring building recorded radiation levels that were off the charts, and the 4 meters per second wind westward meant that emergency sirens had to be sounded in order to keep everyone inside. On the inside of the reactor building, within 2 minutes, the automatic radiation detectors had sounded, and everyone was forced to wear respirators 7 minutes later. Within 20 minutes, there were 5,000 milligrams of radiation per hour. For context, the average American receives about 620 milligrams of radiation per year, or 0.07 milligrams per hour. Just 30 minutes later, the order was given to evacuate the entire plant. Afterwards, an interesting fact about the cleanup was that no one worker was allowed to work for more than 10 minutes. Fortunately, throughout disaster and the subsequent cleanup, no one lost their lives to radiation. And the plant was back up and running in 2 years and protected itself against any future incidents. But, I'm sorry to say, despite their efforts, it still wouldn't be enough. Part 2, the reawakening, would still occur. But that's a video for another day. I hope you have a fantabulous 24 hours, and thank you for watching.